Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and start sharing my screen. So if we run into any other problems, we can try to troubleshoot them. Computer's acting really goofy and slow tonight. So the plan is to get through chapters 4 and 5 and then have you do chapter 6 on your own so that we don't have to spend a lot of extra time in class. I think by this point, you've gotten the hang of what we're doing here. So I'm going to rely on you to do chapter 6 on your own. The quizzes for 4, 5, and 6 are live now, and they will be live until next Monday. So you need to be sure that you get those done. Quizzes 1, 2, and 3 are closing Friday. So if you don't have those done, let's get them done, because once they close, they're closed. Because I've reopened them several times now, and I can't just keep reopening them. We'll never, ever, ever get them done. So don't forget to do that. Let's see, anything else I need to tell you right now? I don't think so. Okay, let's go ahead and get started. We started with hillbilly and country and western music. Now, you may think country and western music and rock and roll don't have anything to do with each other, but that is not true.
Hillbilly and country and western music, first called hillbilly music by record labels, early country and western music was recorded in southern areas of the United States by ambitious record producers who were looking for a new, commercially appealing sound. With the advent of radio, this type of music became incredibly popular, spawning a number of subgenres such as bluegrass, honky-tonk, and country crooning. The film popularity of singers such as Gene Autry also cemented the image of the singing cowboy in the minds of many Americans. As we will see, early country and western music had many themes and images that continue to permeate country music to this day.
Okay, the speakers are not working, so give me just a moment. Let's see if we can figure out why, so that we can hear each other. Folks on Zoom, can you hear okay? I'm not sure why we can't hear better, Curtis. That's not how this is supposed to be working. We're going to give it our best shot. So early country and western music was first called hillbilly music, and it was recorded in the American South by record producers who were looking for something new and commercially appealing. With the advent of radio, this type of music became very popular and spawned a bunch of subgenres in the 1940s, like bluegrass, honky tonk.
Sorry, I was a tad late.
I'm sorry.
Sorry, I was a tad late.
I'm glad to see you, though, Andrew. and country crooning. There were also things like Western swing that came out of this time period in the 40s in particular. Some names that you might have heard of before: Gene Autry was a singing cowboy. There were others like Roy Rogers. Dale Evans was his wife. And Hank Williams, this is Hank Williams Sr., was the kind of the prototype for the troubled honky-tonk singer who made his music in the 40s and the early 50s and died very young. So the roots of country music are in the Anglo-American musical traditions from the southern United States. Country music was buried in the mountains and flatlands of the southeastern United States until the early 1920s, when Ralph Peer, here's Ralph Peer, the recording director for OK, remember that's a record label, we've talked about that record label previously, sought new genres of music to record, promote, and sell. Folklorists had studied and categorized this Celtic music earlier in the 20th century, but Peer was not interested in scholarly investigations or preservation. He was a businessman, so he was looking for music that white folk music would buy and would have commercial appeal in radio and recordings. The majority of early hillbilly music focused on instrumental performances, and only rarely did the musicians create identities as singers. For example, Riley Puckett, who was a blind singer, recorded Rock All Your Babies to Sleep in 1924. And this song is generally regarded as the first recorded example of yodeling in country music. Love it or hate it, yodeling has been part of country music for a long time. Fiddlin' John Carson also recorded several songs on which he fiddled and sang, such as The Little Old Log Cabin in the Lane. So let's take a time out there and hear those two songs. Here's Rock All Our Babies to Sleep. Maybe. Come on, Spotify. Play nice.
A lover
This would be yodeling in case you've never heard it. Again, there's an example of where art imitates life. Again, if you haven't seen O Brother, Where Art Thou, there's quite a bit of yodeling in O Brother, Where Art Thou, too. So if you haven't checked that out, you should do it. Let's hear The Little Old Log Cabin in the Lane. Here's Fiddlin' John Carson with his fiddle on his knee. It's eventually going to play. Maybe not. Sorry, folks. technology situation tonight is not good. Okay, let's see if that makes any difference or not. Seriously? I really, really don't know what the problem is tonight. But it's doing that venom thing again too, which I hate. We can hear him. Question is, why won't Spotify play nice? Let's just try to come back in, shall we? Right there, because I think you get the idea. It took us a long time to get there, so we're going to go on. It's worth noting that when Peter first heard Carson, that's Phil and John Carson that we just listened to, he thought Carson's singing was terrible and the only one to record his fiddle tunes. Holt Brockman, the director of the photograph department at an Atlanta record store, convinced Peter to record Carson singing as well. Brockman told Peter that Carson's sounds would appeal to Southern listeners, and he even offered to buy 500 copies of the recording even before it was pressed. That's a lot of copies, especially at that time. Those 500 copies sold almost immediately, and Polk ordered 500 more. Recognizing his mistake, Peter invited Carson to sign with OK and record 12 songs. By 1927, Peter had left OK and formed his own publishing firm, and he was now lining up talent for the big record companies. He advertised in local newspapers and set up temporary recording locations in order to encourage local talent to record for him. Again, an Oh Brother, Where Art Thou reference. They bring people in to sing into their can, as they called it. It was the microphone, but they called it singing in the can, and record songs there at the radio station, and they would sell copies of those songs. In exchange for his services, Peter can retain copyright ownership of all the music he recorded. That's a big deal. If you have copyright ownership, you get to say when it's sold, how it's sold, and you get a large chunk of the profits of that. The people who did the recording, if their contract wasn't very good, wouldn't necessarily get a whole lot of money for what they were putting down on those records. In fact, he is listed as co-author on much of this music, which allowed him royalties from its sales. Royalties. Royalties means money. Country music history was made in August 1927 in Bristol, Tennessee. Several dozen acts responded to Peer's advertising, and two of these groups were among the most influential forces in early country music. The Carter family was one of the most successful commercially successful of these early country music groups. A.P. Carter married Sarah Doherty in 1915, and their home in Macy's Springs, Virginia, soon became a neighborhood hangout for local music fans and performers. When Mabel Addington married E.G. Carter, A.P.'s brother, in 1926, she brought into the family her superb skills on auto harp, banjo, and guitar. If you don't know what an auto harp is, that's this. It's an auto harp. We used to have them in every elementary music classroom back in the day, but not a lot of people use them anymore. Over the years, the Carters recorded some 300 compositions on a dozen or more labels. That's a lot of music, becoming one of the most influential acts in the history of early country music. Sarah sang soprano, Maybelle sang alto, and AP sang bass or baritone, depending on the song. That disposition of harmony parts is still common in Southern gospel trios today. Maybelle Carter, here she is, revolutionized the use of guitar by developing a technique called the Carter Scratch. You're gonna tell me? The Carter Scratch is a guitar technique in which she used her thumb to play the melody on the guitar's bass strings, and then she supported the melody by strumming her fingers over the other strings. That takes some skill. She was one of the first guitarists to use the guitar as a melodic instrument rather than just as harmonic support in the rhythm section. This technique can be heard in the introduction of My Honey Lou and Keep on the Sunny Side. So let's take a moment here. Come on. Let's hear Keep on the Sunny Side. I'm going to pick and choose here. So Maybelle is actually singing lead here. And then AP and Sarah join in. So we're right here. There's AP. You can hear her playing the bass strings are playing the melody.
Let us grow in our
outro. Same as the intro. Mabel Carter's guitar style and some of her specific licks or short melodic motives can be heard in almost any modern guitarist version of Wildwood Flower, which is one of the Carter family's special numbers. For over half a century, guitarists have acknowledged Mabel Carter as a major influence on their guitar playing. A.P. Carter wrote a good number of tunes for the group also, and after they moved from Victor to Columbia and Decca, those are record labels, he secured copyrights on both his own works and the public domain traditional songs, many of which were deep fundamentalist Christian songs. Can the Circle Be Unbroken is an adaptation of the hymn, Will the Circle Be Unbroken, which was a popular song with many Protestant congregations. The remainder of the Carter's recordings consisted of secular songs on topics of intense grief and despair, a trope which remains common in country music to this day. Amen. In later years, Mabel Carter's three daughters, Helen, June, and Anita, joined the Carter family. And even after the elder Carters divorced, the group itself held together. After a while, Mabel and her three daughters continued on by themselves until Mabel's death. June Carter eventually married Johnny Cash, and the family music tradition continues among the many Carter relatives in Virginia during the 21st century. So June Carter of the Carter family marries Johnny Cash. And hopefully you know that name too. The second artist that Ralph Peer found during his Bristol, Tennessee recording session was Jimmy Rogers. Here he is. Jimmy Rogers' style drew on his early experience with an exposure to African-American blues and work songs. Rogers had a sad life in many ways. His mother died when he was four, and he was soon discovered to have tuberculosis in late adolescence. With no formal schooling, Rogers followed his father around the railroad gangs from one job to another. It was here that he learned 12-bar blues and work songs from the African-American railroad workers and learned to play the banjo and guitar. He worked as a railroad brakeman, a city detective, a vaudeville performer, and a blackface musician until he made his first recording for Peer. In his first recording session, he sang his versions of two traditional songs accompanying himself on the acoustic guitar. On the second, Sleep Baby Sleep, he yodeled. Here it is again. Although hillbilly musicians had been yodeling for decades, Rogers was the first to make the gesture famous. So love it or hate it, you can blame Jimmy Rogers. During his sessions with Victor, he recorded 12 yodels. The first of these is known as T for Texas, although Victor listed it as Blue Yodel when it was released, because it would have greater appeal if it wasn't specific to Texas. Rogers was one of the first country music stars, recording for Victor, traveling in vaudeville shows, playing the occasional radio show, and traveling on modest tours. His poor health prevented him from traveling too extensively, which negatively affected how much he was able to promote himself. He died in New York in 1933 after completing his final recording session. So let's hear a little Jimmy Rogers. Let's see. Let's hear T for Texas. Also known as Blue Yodel. Hear that 12-bar blues setting up? Your dream can fall. Well, that's not very nice. Instrumental break. You can see why they called it blue yodel, because it's set up like a 12-bar blues tune, right? They say it, they say it again, and they say something new. And then they have a little break. In this case, it's a yodel break. And then they do the same thing again. They say it again, then they say something new. So it's set up just like 12-bar blues, which is, I'm sure, why they decided to name it blue yodel at the time. Several factors affected how hillbilly music was composed, recorded, and consumed, one of the most important of which was the rise in popularity and accessibility of the radio. Remember, this is pre-TV, but you could, if you had a radio, you could hear programs from all over the country. There were some very powerful radio stations, especially in New York and in Chicago. And so you could hear programs from very far away on the radio. That was mind-blowing to folks at the time. WSB in Atlanta, Georgia, seems to be the first radio station to present country music, which was followed soon by WBAP in Fort Worth, Texas. These early stations were unregulated, and their signals often traveled, as far as Canada, New York, Haiti, and Hawaii. That's a long way. The most important weekly barn dance program, at least for a while, was the National Barn Dance from WLS in Chicago. WLS broadcast its first group of country fiddlers from a small mezzanine in the Sherman Hotel on April 19, 1924. The surprising response pleased the radio station executives, and they quickly formed the WLS Barn Dance, changed shortly to National Barn Dance. Mixing pop entertainers with country music acts, the show grew to be a huge success, and it moved Chicago's 8th Street Theater in 1932. It was picked up for national distribution by NBC in 1933. That's a big deal. In addition to the regular country music stars, National Barn Dance presented a number of personalities who went on to various careers in show business. Gene Autry, who we mentioned earlier as a singing cowboy, Correll and Godston, who turned out to be Amos and Andy on the radio, Jim and Marion Jordan, who became Fibber McGee and Molly, which was another very popular radio comedy program, Lonesome George Goebel, and many others. Stop it. Okay. George D. Hay had been a strong member of the WLS team in Chicago, and he was hired to be station director for WSM in Nashville, Tennessee. He created the WSM Barn Dance and served as its announcer and host. The WSM Barn Dance program followed Walter Damrosch's NBC Music Appreciation Hour, a program devoted to classical music. So we went from classical music to this early form of country. One early Saturday evening in 1926, Hay told his audience, "For the past hour, we've been listening to music taken largely from grand opera. But from now on, we will present the Grand Ole Opry." The name stuck, and the Grand Ole Opry radio program is still broadcast weekly, the oldest continuous radio program in media history. I have not personally been to the Opry, but you can attend it in Nashville to this day, and country music stars play there. It's a very big deal to be voted a member of the Opry. That's something that young country music folks really covet. They want to be a member of the Opry. Another important change in the music industry that affected hillbilly musicians was the creation of BMI, which is Broadcast Music Incorporated, in 1940. Until 1940, ASCAP, which is the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers, completely dominated the market, holding the royalty rights for nearly 90% of music that was played on the radio. ASCAP was constantly battling with the four major radio networks, ABC, CBS, NBC, and Mutual, over profits. To sidestep ASCAP's monopoly, the four major radio networks formed BMI, which was a rival licensing agency. Musicians who had been ignored or rejected by ASCAP flocked to BMI, and these musicians included hillbilly artists and rhythm and blues musicians. Rhythm and blues musicians are going to be mainly Black. BMI gave these musicians the opportunity to publish their compositions and receive royalties, a practice which was rare before 1940. Remember, if you didn't have that good contract and somebody else held your copyright, they were gobbling up your profits. But once BMI came along, that began to change. The ASCAP strike of 1941 also contributed to the increased success and visibility of many early hillbilly and country and western artists. Tired of fighting with the radio networks over royalties in 1941, ASCAP called for a strike and withdrew the rights for any station to broadcast the material of ASCAP members. That's a really big deal because remember, ASCAP at that time held about 90% of the royalty rights. That's a lot of music that radio stations could not play. This left an enormous hole in the broadcast programming of the major networks, and BMI rushed in to fill it. During the 30s and 40s, the Great Depression, the Dust Bowl, and resulting economic conditions led millions of white Southerners to migrate north in search of stable employment and better lives. The abrupt urban concentrations of Southerners in cities such as Nashville, Atlanta, and Detroit increased the demand for the new genre of country and Western music. Singers such as Roy Acuff sang songs on themes of sentimentality, patriotism, and morality. Acuff's Great Speckled Bird, for example, conveys a religious message while combining a straightforward singing style with bottleneck guitar techniques that he borrowed from the African-American blues tradition. Let's hear Great Speckled Bird.
Mistake. Christ the Lord. When he comes, descending from heaven, on the clouds as he rides in his word, I'll be joyful and to be here. Wings of that great speckled bird.
Oh. Huh. Everything just kind of went poof. Hang on. Another icon of the country and Western music scene in the 1930s and 40s was the singing cowboy, an image cultivated by singers such as Gene Autry and Roy Rogers in film, radio, and television beginning in the 1930s. The most popular singing cowboy of the time was Gene Autry. He was created not by recording and radio, however, but by the movies. Autry made several recordings in New York, and then he took a steady job in Chicago on the WLS Barn Dance's Oklahoma's Singing Cowboy. The Sears organization took notice of his growing popularity and promoted his records on the Silvertone, which was Sears' record label, along with Gene Autry's Roundup guitar and assorted songbooks and guitar instruction books. You could buy all those in the Sears Roebuck catalog. Now, all of you young people are too young to remember the Sears Roebuck catalog, but it was about 4 inches thick, and it would arrive at your house in late October, early November, and you spend months going through it, picking out what you wanted for Christmas out of the Sears catalog. I remember doing that when I was a little girl. In 1934, Autry went to Hollywood for a screen test, and he eventually ended up performing in nearly 100 different films. I said 100 different films. That's a lot. In films such as the 12-part serial, The Phantom Empire, Autry cultivated the image of the singing cowboy. Now, a serial, in case you don't know what that is, was a series of short films, kind of like a TV series today, but these were at the movies. And so every week you had to go back to the movies to see the next installment of the serial. And that brought people back to the theater over and over again. My father was born in the late 30s, and he talks about going to the movies, and for a nickel, you could see a double feature, the cereal, the cartoons, and get a bag of popcorn and a soda. That's a pretty good deal for a nickel. The presence of a singing cowboy also emphasized the Western part of the country and Western music. Between 1940 and 1956, Autry hosted a weekly show on CBS radio called Gene Autry's Melody Ranch, in which he promoted the 10 Cowboy Commandments, a series of guidelines that encouraged his listeners to live ethical and patriotic lives. His horse champion also had his own radio program. I don't know anything about that, but I'm going to find out. Autry also began starring in his own TV series on CBS in 1950. Now that was pretty early in TV's advent. We were just coming out of the radio era and into the TV era at that time. Autry's music, in combination with his appearances on radio, television, and film, helped move country and Western music into the popular mainstream. He also inspired a number of commercial rivals, such as Roy Rogers. Let's see. After World War II, country and Western music became increasingly popular. By 1949, over 650 radio stations were regularly broadcasting live performances by country and Western musicians. This expansion in country and Western music also led to the development of several important subgenres and star artists. First, the country crooner. A country crooner is a country singer who sings sentimental songs in an intimate and pop-oriented style. They sang to appeal to a broad range of audiences, especially females, exemplified by artists such as Eddie Arnold, The country crooners sang sentimental songs in a style that suggested physical proximity and friendly intimacy. Next, bluegrass musicians. Bluegrass is a style of music that focuses on performing and reviving traditional Southern music. I love bluegrass music. They considered that the roots of country music of the American South. Bill Monroe is considered the inventor of bluegrass, and we will consider his music in greater detail during a later lesson. And finally, honky-tonk music was louder and rougher. It involved electric instruments once they came along, vocal cracks, and influences of African-American music with a heavy beat. They were meant to convey the spirit of a juke joint or a roadside bar. Honky-tonk ensembles usually included a fiddle, steel guitar, lead guitar, bass, and piano. Honky-tonk style vocal styles often featured the cracks in the singer's voice, and they borrowed elements of African-American music, such as blue notes, remember those, and melismas. Hank Snow, Kitty Wells, and George Jones, who should be a familiar name to you, are among the many honky-tonk artists who were popular during the 1950s. The biggest honky-tonk star of the era, however, was Hank Williams. This is Hank Williams Sr. Here he is right here. Williams captured the hearts and minds of hundreds of thousands of country music fans in his brief career. He was the son of an Alabama sharecropper and raised in poverty. He listened to the recordings of Roy Acuff and Ernest Tubb, but he was also deeply affected by African-American musical traditions. Although the amount of his influence cannot be established, a Black singer named Rufus Payne mentored Williams for a while, teaching him songs and guitar techniques. Williams was also affected by the religious music that he heard in the fundamentalist Baptist churches he attended as a child. Williams began his career on the Louisiana Hayride, a radio program that aired on KWKH from Shreveport, Louisiana. Only 4 months after he joined the Louisiana Hayride, he was recruited to appear at the Grand Ole Opry. That's pretty quick. The Grand Ole Opry chose Williams based largely on the success of his recording of Lovesick Blues, which we'll hear shortly. Lovesick Blues was actually a tune from 1922 by Tin Pan Alley songwriter Irving Mills and Cliff Friend, and it had been recorded by several other country artists, but Williams' rendition is considered the definitive version of this song. Let's hear Lovesick Blues. Come on. So almost a yodel, not quite a yodel.
Thank you.
William saw his music as an extension of his own thoughts and feelings. As he once explained, when a hillbilly sings a crazy song, he feels crazy. When he sings, "I laid my mother away," he sees her laying right there in the coffin. Many of his songs from the early 1950s speak of tragedy and longing, such as "Cold, Cold Heart" and "Your Cheating Heart." Although these songs were not necessarily autobiographical statements, they did speak to a sense of struggle and heartbreak that Williams felt in his own life. To Williams, hillbilly musicians were more sincere than most entertainers because the hillbilly was raised rougher than most musicians. You gotta know a lot about hard work. Williams' short life was marked with difficulty. He was fired from the Grand Ole Opry in 1942 because of his constant drunkenness, which led him to return to the Louisiana hayride. A painful congenital spine condition left him with a stooped posture and an addiction to prescription painkillers. When he was sober, he gave remarkable live performances, but more often than not, he was too drunk to perform. Williams died just shy of his 30th birthday of a heart attack, brought on by a lifetime of substance abuse. Despite his incredibly short career, Williams was and remains one of the most influential figures in the history of country music, and yes, he is the father of Hank Williams Jr. Let's hear "Cheatin' Heart." Okay, so to conclude, with the advent of radio, film, and organizations such as BMI, Early country and Western musicians had many opportunities to promote their music. Radio programs such as the Grand Ole Opry are a testament to the commercial viability and staying power of country music. The migration of Americans from south to north, urban areas of the country also created concentrated listening areas with high demand for this type of music. These musicians incorporated many elements of Anglo-American folk music, such as the instrumentation and modal harmonies, but they also borrowed techniques from African-American musicians, such as blue notes and timbral effects. Superstars such as Gene Autry, Roy Rogers, and Hank Williams set the stage for the next several generation of country music performers. Okay, so the quiz is open now. But we're going to go right on to rhythm and blues.
Rhythm and blues becomes rock and roll. In the early 1950s, many different threads came together to create the earliest rock and roll, blending elements of gospel music, blues, popular song, hillbilly music, and rhythm and blues. Artists such as Ray Charles, Chuck Berry, and Fats Domino wrote and recorded some of the earliest crossover hits. Soon, white artists such as Bill Haley and his Cummins and Pat Boone began recording cover versions of Black artist songs, most of which were more commercially successful than their Black counterparts.
In the early 1950s, many musical threads came together. So we've established that radio is very important at this time period, and TV is just coming into its own. So rhythm and blues is mostly a creation of Black musicians, but as often happens, white artists like Bill Haley are going to come along and borrow from that tradition and also popularize these songs with white audiences. Changes in technology, new and hybrid musical forms, and shifts in musical composition patterns all contributed to a reworking of the American popular music landscape that would forever alter the history of popular music consumption in the United States. The magnetic recording process completely changed how music was recorded and distributed. Development by the Germans to guide their radio-controlled V2 bombs, the magnetic tape recorder revolutionized the music industry. It recorded on magnetic tape and allowed for sound to be recorded, erased, and re-recorded on the same tape many times. So recordings could be duplicated from tape to tape, allowed for recordings to be edited, and made recording much less expensive. Before, we were engraving things on wax cylinders or on wax discs. Now we have this magnetic tape, and so it's much cheaper, and you can use it over and over again. Recording was no longer confined to gigantic and elaborate studios owned by the major companies in a few cities. Tolerably decent recordings could now be made anywhere, at any time of day, by untrained people who knew very little about engineering or acoustics. Around the same time, hi-fi 45 RPM, which means 45 revolutions per minute, that's how fast they turned. Technology exploded onto the scene. These are records we're talking about. Peter Goldmark, the head of CBS Labs for many years, invented hi-fi, and the 33.5 RPM process way in the 1930s. So the 33 and a third was a big album. It was really big with a very small hole in the middle. The 45 was a small album, or a single with a very big hole in the middle, and you had to have an adapter to play them on the same record player. He was designing phonograph equipment to handle the remarkable new product when the war broke out, so everything was put on hold for a few years. After the war, when CBS made its move to 33 and a third, RCA countered, the 45 RPM record, and it immediately invented a small, economical 45 RPM playback unit. These kind of record players are becoming popular again now. You see them in stores again now. They're the ones that kind of have a lid that shuts, and you can pick them up and take them with you. That was so you could take them to parties, and you could play your records at parties. CBS then caught up by making a three-speed turntable with an adapter for the 45 RPM option. Time out. Gotta get a drink. I'm tired of coughing. The result of this corporate warfare was a huge jump in pop singles. They would record one song on one side and then a B-side on the other. So you got two songs on that little record. 45 RPMs were small, less expensive to produce, and less expensive for consumers to purchase. It was in the world of 45 RPM singles, two sides, the favorite one called the A-side, and the throwaway was the B-side, that rhythm and blues had its first great moment in pop music history. So here's a jukebox, in case you've never seen one in the wild. And this held maybe even hundreds of 45 records. And you put your money in and you punch these buttons and it would tell the jukebox which one to keep to queue up and play. Today, these are digital, but back in the day, it held actual records. About the same time, several new types of electric keyboard instruments appeared. The Hammond B3 organ's basic sound was created by small discs rotating through a magnetic field. That sound was amplified through a slowly rotating Leslie speaker. The player's right foot controlled the dynamics with a large pedal about the size of an accelerator on a truck. Down near the player's left foot was an octave pedal board, like on a pipe organ. The Fender Rhodes electric piano also appeared about the same time. Harold Rhodes invented the piano when he needed more instruments for therapeutic music sessions he was giving to wounded military men. He took some spare hydraulic parts from an old B-17 bomber and fashioned a working piano. The first Fender Rhodes electric pianos fit on a hospital tray so the men could practice without getting out of bed. Music listening and consumption was also affected by the radio. The transistor radio, which was small and portable, developed by Bell Laboratory in 1947, appeared on the market in the early 1950s. About the same time, the car radio became an affordable option in the automobile industry, and people began listening to the radio in their cars as well as in their homes. By the late 1940s and 50s, many popular talk, drama, and comedy radio programs had moved from radio to television. And radio programmers needed to find new material to fill the airtime. Several innovations in radio programming arose, the most important of which was the development of the Top 40 radio format. The Top 40 was a radio format where the same 40 tunes were repeated once every 24-hour radio cycle. So in order to get on the Top 40, your record had to be a hit. They wouldn't play things that weren't selling, because that would be a waste of airtime. People would turn the station to try to hear a song they liked. So if you wanted to be on the Top 40, you had to have a hit. The same 40 records would be repeated, and the top 10 songs would receive more frequent play than the bottom 30. In addition, Top 40 radio integrated short news spots, contests, promotional gimmicks, and frequent radio station identification spots by talkative disc jockeys speaking the language of the teenage listening market. Why 40 tunes? Because the world through jukeboxes, which flooded the industry at the time, contained, guess how many? 40 records. The rise of radio and Top 40 radio made the disc jockey, who is the person that introduces and plays music on the radio, a very popular and important music promoter. The most important disc jockey of the era, and indeed one of the most important figures in the promotion of early rock and roll music, was Alan Freed. Here he is right here, Alan Freed. He was trained in trombone and music theory, and Freed was quite successful with his early evening classical music program. As he saw the musical and commercial appeal of African-American popular music, he began promoting this new music to his listeners. Freed obtained permission from the radio station owner to follow his classical program with a program of rhythm and blues music. Aware that the term rhythm and blues would likely drive away his white audience, Freed picked up the phrase rock and roll from a rhythm and blues recording and began using rock and roll instead of rhythm and blues. This is why rock and roll was called rock and roll, because Alan Freed said so. It's still not known whether or not Freed knew the term rock and roll was used as a slang term in the African-American community as a euphemism for sex. Regardless, rock and roll is typically used to describe rhythm and blues music from the 1950s that was geared to an audience of teenage listeners, whether they were black or white. Freed was an exciting personality to hear on the radio. He would often shout, "Yeah, yeah, yeah, go man, go," into the microphone while he pounded on a telephone book in rhythm to the music. As his theme song, he chose a King Records recording by Todd Rhodes called Blues for Moondog, and he therefore called his show the Moondog Rock and Roll House Party. He even began to call himself Moondog. Shortly after, a blind New York street musician named Moondog sued the station. And after a $5,000 settlement, which doesn't sound like a lot today, but was a lot then, the name of the show was changed to Alan Freed's Rock and Roll Party. Freed used his celebrity to promote Black musicians despite the racism that was rampant in American society. He sponsored concerts which featured Charles Brown, the Orioles, the Moonglows, the Dominoes, and many other rhythm and blues acts. In March of 1953, he sold 18,000 tickets for an auditorium that only had 9,000 seats. Uh-oh. When 18,000 screaming teenagers appeared, he had to cancel the show. And police vans hauled away the rioting youngsters to cool them off in jail for a few hours. Not good. In 1954, at age 33, Freed went to WINS in New York and was soon making nearly $1 million a year, not only playing, but selling records over the air, along with dozens of other teenage commodities made by his sponsors. He became a spokesman for the new teenage subculture, and soon he appeared in three movies: Don't Knock the Rock, 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 and Rock Around the Clock. I think it's Don't Knock the Rock, comma, Rock, 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 comma, and Rock Around the Clock. I think there should be maybe a semicolon there. Freed used many different tactics to promote recordings on the air, and not all of them were exactly illegal or even ethical. He accepted bribes from online companies to play their recordings. That would later be called payola. He struck deals with singers and songwriters in exchange for top spots on his program. For example, in return for being listed as co-author on Chuck Berry's Maybelline, Freed promoted the record on his Cleveland radio show, and it rose to number one in the rhythm and blues charts and number five on the pop charts. Freed eventually was summoned before Congress and indicted for accepting bribes from record companies to push their recordings, which we will discuss in greater detail later on. Regardless of the tactics he used to promote this new popular music, Freed was one of the driving forces behind the popularity of this new rock and roll music. Did you catch where Freed was a DJ first? Cleveland? Guess why we have the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland? Because that's where Alan Freed coined the term rock and roll. Let's hear Maybelline. It's Chuck Berry, who was from St. Louis. So you can see that the blues part of the rhythm and blues here, where we sing "Oh Maybelline, Why Can't You Be True" and repeat it, and then say something else.
Pretty catchy song. Where's the time?
Thank you. We got the fade out there. Andrew, did you have some? Did you have something to ask?
Oh no, I was just going to say I've heard that song before and it's pretty catchy.
There you go. Yeah, we're finally getting up to the place where you've probably heard some of this music.
Yeah.
One of the first artists to move freely between gospel music and rhythm and blues and achieve commercial success was Ray Charles. Here he is, Ray Charles. Ray Charles lost his sight at the age of 7 to a rare form of childhood glaucoma. He studied music in Florida at the St. Augustine School for the Blind and learned to read and write music in Braille. When his parents died, he left school at age 16 to make it on his own as a musician. Wrapping the sounds and rhythms of Black gospel music around traditional secular lyrics made Ray Charles one of the most influential musicians of the 20th century. He used jazz-style horn riffs in many of his arrangements. He was among the first musicians to use the Fender Rhodes electric piano. He joined a hillbilly band for a short time and learned how to yodel. By the way, that's tonight's code word. If you're watching this recording, tonight's code word is yodel. Don't forget to send me the code word by Monday so you can get credit for attendance. He formed a female backup group called the Raylettes. And they served as a model for later girl groups such as the Supremes. Everything he did was charged with electrical energy and emotional intensity. Charles had a strong and unmistakable style of his own, a raspy, passionate, gospel-soaked, oratorical delivery that turned every song into an emotional event. In 1952, Charles signed with Atlantic Records and began recording songs that freely blended gospel with rhythm and blues. Although some listeners were shocked at Charles's combination of sacred and secular genres in this new style of gospel blues, he saw no reason to separate the two styles of music. In his autobiography, he wrote, "I've been singing spiritual since I was 3. And I've been hearing the blues for just as long. What could be more natural than to combine them?" Charles' combinations often took the form of adapting the melodies and lyrics of gospel songs into electrifying rhythm and blues numbers. He converted talking about Jesus to talking about you, and I got a savior to I got a woman. This little light of mine became this little girl of mine. I Got a Woman in 1954. Charles adapted the lyrics of the gospel song, I Got a Savior, and borrowed the melody and harmonic progressions from the Southern Tones gospel recordings, Must Be Jesus. Charles turned up the volume of his gospel sources, adding electric instruments, secular lyrics, and a high-energy performing style. Charles has sometimes been called the greatest gospel singer alive, but he actually never recorded a straightforward gospel song. This hybrid of gospel and rhythm and blues is nowhere more apparent than in What I'd Say from 1959, complete with moaning that trends the line between religious ecstasy and sexual delight. The frenzied music that builds to a fever pitch would be right at home in a religious service, and the groan, call, and response passages between Charles and his backup singers are just as suited to a rhythm and blues recording as they are a gospel song. So let's hear What I'd Say. This is another one that you have probably heard somewhere. I always love that drum ostinato. So that would be the electric piano we've been talking about.
See you go with the dark rain.
She knows how to shake that thing up right now. Hey, hey, hey. Tell you what, I'm gonna send you back to Arkansas. Oh, yes, well, you don't do it right. Don't do it right. Oh, I pray for when you see me in misery, come on and see if I can help you. Hey, hey, all right. See the girl with the record song. She can do the bird that I can find. Yeah.
So we have some call and response between Charles and the band. It's a basic 12-bar blues form. Just dressed up a little. While other artists such as Ray Charles were stitching gospel and rhythm and blues together, other rock and roll artists were taking stylistic gestures from early rhythm and blues artists such as Louis Jordan, and adding electrified instruments to their music. These artists also borrowed elements from hillbilly music and country and western. One of the most important artists in this style of rhythm and blues was Chuck Berry. You see him here playing his electric guitar, whom many historians consider to be the father of rock and roll. Berry's vocal delivery style was heavily influenced by country and western music. In fact, his delivery resembled that of country artists so much that many listeners were surprised to learn that Berry was in fact black. Berry was already a veteran nightclub entertainer when he transformed Ida Red, which is a country western tune that had been recorded by several Nashville country artists, such as Bob Bowles and his Texas Playboys and Roy Acuff, to a giant hit, Maybelline. So Ida Red is going to turn into Maybelline. Maybelline includes Barry's basic guitar style, which was and remains one of the most influential styles of playing in the history of recorded music. His introductions, double note solos, and alternating accompaniment chords defined Barry's style and influenced guitarists for generations to come. Further, Barry performed his famous duck walk during guitar solos, a gesture which became an iconic part of his performances. Like many of his songs, Maybelline borrows its harmonic structure from the 12-bar blues. The song is in verse-chorus form, not the 12-bar blues form. So we just heard Maybelline talking about the cars and, you know, chasing Maybelline down. We talked about how it sets up as a 12-bar blues, but doesn't continue that way. If you go to St. Louis and you go down on Delmar Street, go to Blueberry Hill, because Blueberry Hill has a performance venue called the Duck Room, because that's where Chuck Berry liked to perform a lot in that room at Blueberry Hill. And that's why they call it the Duck Room, because of his duck walk. In his songs, Berry treated topics that were of the utmost concern to the new teen culture in the United States, whether the listeners were black or white. Cars, girl-boy problems, school, music, growing up, and parents. Some things never change. Tracks such as School Days, Sweet Little 16, and Johnny Be Good are just a few examples. Rollover Beethoven mocks conservative adult culture, claiming that the excitement of rhythm and blues would probably cause the composer to roll over in his grave. I think not. I think Beethoven would have dug rock and roll. I think he was always looking for the next new thing. I think he would have dug rock and roll. So you've probably heard Johnny Be Good. So let's hear Roll Over Beethoven. That's one that some people don't know. I was too impatient. Okay, let's hear Roll Over Beethoven. It sounds like the intro to Johnny Be Good, right? So just a couple of things there. Blue Suede Shoes was a song recorded originally by Carl Perkins, but it was an even bigger hit for Elvis Presley later on. As long as she's got a dime, that's how much it costs to play the jukebox, was a dime. Glowworm was a popular song in the 1930s and early 40s. So he's making a lot of references here to older music and what's going on now. So, you know, again, he's trying to appeal directly to the teenage population who are going to buy his record. Berry was just one of several artists to achieve crossover success in the 1950s. A crossover is a song that holds a prominent place on at least two of the three types of charts. At the time, there was the pop chart, the rhythm and blues chart, and the country chart. Now we have several other kinds. The laid-back rhythm and blues pianist Fats Domino achieved crossover success with songs such as Blueberry Hill and Ain't That a Shame, both of which charted on the rhythm and blues charts and then crossed over to pop charts. Who's Fats Domino? Right here. Little Richard, a far more flamboyant performer than either Berry or Domino, crossed over from rhythm and blues to pop with songs like Long Tall Sally and Good Golly Miss Molly. Artists such as Little Richard and Big Joe Turner recorded songs that were often considered too explicit for pop, or that's code for white, audiences, which led to the phenomenon of the cover version. So they'd take a Little Richard song that they thought was too risque, and a white artist would cover it and would change the lyrics a little bit to make it a little more palatable and would sell lots and lots of copies. So let's hear Ain't That a Shame.
Or try. Oh. But they won't.
This is Fats Domino.
They won't really.
You made me cry. We said goodbye. Ain't that a shame? You broke my heart when you said we'll part. Ain't that a shame? My tears fill the rain.
Take a look at this album cover here. This isn't an original of the time, but it's interesting that they've got Fats playing piano and his backup musicians are black, but the couple that's dancing happens to be white. I find that interesting. Also, if you look down here in the corner, here's Fats Domino and his band, but look at his audience. His audience is primarily white. That's probably from a movie, but given the quality of the picture or the screen capture, but I don't know which one. Rock and roll movies were a big thing right then. Okay, let's, if you're Ain't That a Shame, let's hear Good Golly, Miss Molly. This is Little Richard. Little Richard was Prince before Prince? Here he is right here. He had this pencil thin mustache and he wore eyeliner. This is in the 50s now. Little Richard was a force of nature. He would stand up to play piano. He'd jump all around. Super high energy. Little Richard was considered pretty risque for the time. Okay, we'll come back to that. Artists such as Little Richard and Big Joe Turner recorded songs were often considered too explicit. So white artists began to cover their stuff. Teenagers may have loved rhythm and blues lyrics such as "I Got a Girl Named Sue, She Knows Just What to Do." That comes from Tutti Frutti, which is also a Little Richard tune. "And you're wearing those dresses, the sun comes shining through. I can't believe my eyes, all this belongs to you." From Big Joe Turner's Shake, Rattle, and Roll. But parents, record companies began releasing cover versions of Black artist songs. In general, a cover version is a song that is re-recorded by another artist. And depending on your recording contract, you either got royalties when somebody else covered your stuff or you didn't. It was important that you watched your contract. During the early age of rock and roll, these cover versions had a very specific purpose: to modify Black artists' rhythm and blues songs in order to make them more appropriate for white audiences. The sexual references in the original black versions were muted, modified, or completely deleted. The Black artists delivered all those sexual innuendos in jest with good humor. The double entendres and playful metaphoric lyrics were common in rhythm and blues, but white record executives interpreted them as devious, overtly sexual, and thus unfit for white audiences' consumption. Oh, we could not sully their good little boy and good little girl ears. Recordings by the squeaky clean white singer Pat Boone exemplified the goals of early cover versions. Boone's cover of "Ain't That a Shame" and "Tutti Frutti" were highly sanitized versions of the Black rhythm and blues originals, but they achieved far more commercial success than the original songs that Boone was covering, at least in the 1950s. So we just heard "Ain't That a Shame," the original. You'll hear "Ain't That a Shame," if I can find it. Here we go. Here's "Ain't That a Shame," covered by Pat Boone.
"You made me cry. You said goodbye. Ain't that a shame?
It's like they stripped the soul out of the song. Okay, I'm going to stop right there because that's about all the Pat Boone I can do right now. Another success story among cover artists was Bill Haley. Bill Haley often claimed to have invented rock and roll, but that is not true. Haley was, however, one of the first artists to achieve commercial success with crossover versions of rhythm and blues songs. Because Bill Haley and his band was called The Comets. During his musical career, Haley was first a country yodeler, and then a disc jockey, and then the leader of the Four Aces of Western Swing, later called the Saddlemen. So he started out in country music, and they played country and western. In 1951, Haley did a cover of Jackie Brinson's blues release, Rocket 88. And though the recording only sold a few copies, Haley's live performances of the tune drove his white teenage dancers wild. In response, he renamed his group Bill Haley and the Comets, and he set out to record a new rhythm and blues image for his band. He signed with Decca Records in 1954, and his band promptly covered Sunny Day's 1952 Rock Around the Clock, which is probably what he's best known for, and Big Joe Turner's Shake, Rattle, and Roll. Rock Around the Clock was only modest interest until it appeared in the movie The Blackboard Jungle. After its appearance in the film, it spent 40 weeks in the top 10. So let's hear Rock Around the Clock. I'm willing to bet you heard this one too. 'Theme song to a little show called Happy Days back in the day. C- Comparing the cover version of Shake, Rattle, and Roll by Bill Haley and his Comets with the original version by Big Joe Turner, both of them were in 1954, reveals how white rock and roll cover versions of Black songs worked. In the cover version, suggestive lyrics such as, "You're wearing those dresses, the sun comes shining through," are scrubbed into, "Wearing those dresses, your hair done up so nice." Despite this modification of the lyrics, Haley consciously modeled his musical style on that of Black musicians, Louis Jordan in particular. According to Haley's producer, Milt Gabler, "We begin with Jordan's shuffle rhythm, you know, dotted eighth notes and sixteenths, and we build on it. Bill Haley and the Comets got a sound that had the drive of the timpani five and the color of country and western. The 12-bar blues verses of Shake, Rattle, and Roll, combined with country and western background of Bill Haley's band, led to a definitive sound for these early crossover hits." So to conclude, disc jockey Alan Freed from Cleveland began using the term rock and roll in the 1950s as a way to market rhythm and blues to a wide audience. The invention of top 40 radio and increased availability of radios expanded the listening audiences for rock and roll. Remember, they started putting it in cars. That was a big deal. Early rock and roll artists such as Chuck Berry, Ray Charles, Fats Domino, Big Joe Turner, and Little Richard combined elements of earlier rhythm and blues with country and western music, the 12-bar blues form, and new advances in instrument amplification. Although some of these artists did achieve commercial success, their sales were dwarfed by white artist cover songs, cover versions of their songs. In the next lesson, we will look at the most legendary rock and roll artist of all time, Elvis Presley. So quiz five is open. If it will advance, come on, you can do it. Maybe not. Okay, so what you need to do for next time is do quiz four, do quiz five, and then you need to go through it. Yeah, it's being stupid. There's quiz five. Okay. And you need to go ahead and you need to do the Elvis Presley section and its quiz on your own. Okay. That's going to put us ahead a little bit so that we don't have to do that here in class. I'm going to let you do that on your own because I think you've got the idea of how we need to do these things now. Also, if you want to hear any of those other songs that we skipped over tonight, I didn't play every single piece of music. If you want to hear some of those other songs, you can always go back and listen to them because you have access to all this music. So for next time, quiz four, quiz five, quiz six, be sure to go through the Elvis Presley section, and then we'll pick it up with section seven next time. Does anyone have a question? Okay, if you are listening to the recording, don't forget to send me your code word by Monday. And if there are no questions, I will see you next week.